Hello students, welcome to the new course called as Analysis and Design of Algorithms. Okay, so in this semester I will be handling this particular subject, very interesting and very of course very important subject, because the ever since the mankind started using computers, now everybody wanted to solve some of the problems related to a particular domain by using our machine called as the computers. But why this subject? So why the analysis and design of algorithms, or some author call it as design and analysis of the algorithms, okay, whatever manner you want to name it. But why this analysis and design of the algorithm? So in this course we will be looking in detail about the complete analyzing an algorithm and designing various aspects of designing an algorithm. And of course related to this course you have got a lab also, that is 18 in the next videos we will be dealing with the lab sessions also. Okay, so before starting into the course, let us see the first module, that is in the first module. Now what all the contents we are going to learn in this particular first module. So generally, as usual, as the title says that, now when you split up your title, analysis, design and algorithm, so these are the three important keywords what you are going to see here. So now we will be looking into this, try to understand or try to figure out, so what do you mean by analysis, try to figure out what is the design and then of an algorithm. So in the first module, so introduction, so we will be looking into these things. So later on we will try to look into the some of the fundamental framework. Okay, so what is the fundamental framework we are going to analyze our algorithms and various problem domains, what are the various important problem domains we are having. So we will be looking into those aspects, and we'll try to see, we'll take some of the examples based on the algorithmic notation. Now how to solve these particular example, like recursive algorithms and non-recursive algorithms. So right, so now these are all the things now which we will be trying to cover in this particular module 1. Okay, so now let us start with the algorithms. Now what do you mean by an algorithm, right? So how do you define an algorithm? So as you all know that in order to solve one particular problem, now we are going to give some instructions, right? So in a very simple term, we can see that, or we can define an algorithm is nothing but a sequence of unambiguous instructions, right? You can just note through that particular definition. Algorithm can be defined as a sequence. There is a proper sequence, right? One after the other. One after the other. You have got a sequence of unambiguous instructions. Now, unambiguous instruction means whatever the instructions you are giving in the form of an algorithm. So, which the then this algorithm you are going to feed it into your computer, right? By using some of the programming languages, C, C++, V.NET, etc. So the instructions what you are going to give, it should be very clear. It should be very very simple, very understanding, or in, we say unambiguous. There should not be any confusion in the instruction, because if you make the instructions as confusing, obviously the system cannot perform this instruction in a sequence manner. So we say sequence of unambiguous instructions for solving a particular problem. So you have a particular problem. In order to solve that problem, give some instructions in a sequence manner and see that the instructions what you are going to give is very simple, straightforward. There should not be any confusion. So in order to obtain a required output, right? So we need some output. We are going to solve a problem. So we need some output. Output from a legitimate input, right? So still, what is the continuation of this definition? That is, for obtaining a required output from any legitimate input. Legitimate input means for proper input. So the input should be correct. So you cannot blame that the computer is not working properly, it is giving wrong results. Obviously, our system cannot give wrong results at all until and unless your input is wrong or the way in which you are giving instructions is wrong. Whatever you are giving the instructions, it is going to take the instruction in a sequence manner and it tries to execute. But you have to see that for legitimate input, so the inputs what you are going to give, it should be very clear. And your algorithm, it should come in a finite amount of time. So this is how we try to define an algorithm. So I think it's very clear now. So in a simple term, how do you define an algorithm? It is defined as a sequence of unambiguous instructions for solving a problem. So that is for obtaining a required output for any legitimate input in a fixed amount of time. So this is how we define an algorithm. So now when we are talking of any algorithm, now there are very, very important characteristics of an algorithm, right? So I think all these are very simple things which you might have already discussed in your undergraduate programs. So now let me will try to just rewind that whatever you have studied. So what are the important characteristics? The first important characteristic is input. That means whenever you are going to write an algorithm, now we should have zero or more inputs, or we say the arguments to any algorithm. So like say for example, you want to write a program to add two numbers. Now if you want to write a program to add two numbers, we need two numbers first, right? Input should be given for us. So input is one of the very important characteristics. And when you look into the input, you can have zero input. There are certain algorithms, you can design some programs where you need not, as a user, you need not give the input, right? So we can say that zero input or more input. There can be more than one input, two input, depending upon our particular problem. So first important characteristic is you should have an input. The second important is output. So when you are going to solve a problem, obviously at least there is one output. So you will be having at least one output of any algorithm. Because so when you run your algorithm, when you run your program, the program has to stop at one end. Or you can say that it has to give us the result. So result is very important. If you don't get the result, then we can say in one term that the program what you are going to run in your computer in any programming language, it is going to infinite loop. Infinite loop means the program is not ever ending. But what is the characteristic of an algorithm says that one of the important characteristics, second one, is output. There should be at least one output. You have to generate an output. So the third important characteristic is called as definiteness. That means every step must be precisely well defined. You should define. That's what in definition we said, sequence of unambiguous instructions. So every step in our algorithm must be clearly defined, precisely defined. So what are the actions to be carried out must be properly defined. So there should not be any confusion when you are taking about the instructions or the steps what you are going to write in order to design an algorithm, right? So the third important characteristic is definiteness. The next fourth important characteristic is finiteness. So finiteness means the algorithm must always terminate after finite number of steps. It should terminate. It has to terminate after certain quiet amount of time. The program has to stop. It cannot continuously, it cannot go to infinite loop. Because you see, if your program goes to infinite loop, you won't get an output. So if there is no output, because just now we defined that output is one of the important characteristics. There should be at least one output. If you want an output, means the program has to stop. So we say that the algorithm must always terminate after finite number of steps. So this is the fourth important characteristics. And the next one is effectiveness, right? So what do you mean by effectiveness? Now in general, you know this particular term which we try to use. So effectiveness means, so the algorithm is also, it is generally expected to be proper, effective. That means what is your required output. So all operations or the steps or the instructions what you are going to give in order to solve the problem, it should be basic and feasible, right? It should be very basic and very feasible so that now you can understand. That means anybody can understand. So today I write an algorithm. When I write one algorithm and give you to coding to do code for code that algorithm into any programming language, if you are unable to understand what are the instructions I have given, so then how can you write a program for that? How can you convert that algorithm into a program? So we say that an algorithm becomes an effective when it is very simple, it is very understood. So it should be very simple and it should be very understood. It should be very basic. In a very basic, in a very general term, you are supposed to write the program. So these are the some of the important characteristics what you can try to find in an algorithm, and this is how we are going to define a particular algorithm. So okay, so this slide just now we told that. So what all the concept we are going to learn in this particular module. Okay, so once you have understood now what is your algorithm, what is the general definition of an algorithm, and what are the important characteristics of your algorithm, now let us move into the analysis and design. So why we need this? So why we need to analyze a particular algorithm, or why we need to design a particular algorithm? Okay, now let us take a simple example. Say for example, now you want to purchase one car, or let us say you want to purchase a bike, now or a mobile phone. Now on what basis you are going to purchase a mobile phone? Either your friends might have told you that this phone is very good based on certain characteristics, right? So now you wanted a phone whose memory is very good, you wanted a phone whose processor is very good, or you wanted a phone whose camera is quality is very good. There are so many characteristics, right? You do an analysis. Okay, for this is based on this particular feature, I want to purchase this particular phone. Similarly, now when you are going to write a program, right? So I cannot directly implement that program until and unless I do an analysis of that. So that's what we say, that algorithmic analysis. Now you are going to do analysis on an algorithm. So when you are going to do an analysis on an algorithm, what are the analysis you are going to do? See, as we just told, when you want to do an analysis on a mobile phone, there are so many features. It with the processor speed, or the look of the particular mobile phone. Someone needs a very stylish mobile phone, the weight of that, or it can be the camera, the processor, like this, isn't it? There are so many features. Now, when you are talking of an algorithm, on what basis you have to do the analysis? Now, you can see that the analysis of our algorithm, now it is done on two important features. Now, one is called as the time, which is generally called as time complexity. The other one is called as the space, known as the space complexity. So time complexity, the space complexity. Now if I suppose say that now I have two algorithm to solve one problem. So what is our problem? Addition of two numbers. Okay, so now I have written one program to add two numbers, and you have written a program to add two numbers, right? So because there might be different ways in order to solve a particular problem. So now when we have two program in front of us which is trying to do the same task, now I have to pick any one out of these two program, but which one I'm going to pick up? I do an analysis. Now on what factor I do analysis? I take up the first program and I will check the time complexity. What is the time complexity of this algorithm? Then I take the second algorithm and I check the time complexity of second algorithm, and I will try to compare which one is good for me. I do an analysis based on time complexity, right? That is one factor. The second factor is space complexity. So how much memory it is going to take, later we will see. Okay, so how much memory algorithm A is going to take, what is the space complexity of, what is the space complexity of the second algorithm, and then I come to a conclusion that okay, based on both the time complexity and space complexity, I am going to select second algorithm because that is an best algorithm. This is how we do an analysis of an algorithm. Now, out of these two features, that is time complexity and space complexity, in our entire course, we try to focus mainly on time complexity. We try to ignore the space complexity. Now, why we try to ignore the space complexity is that now, as our technology, as our hardware industry has grown so much that nowadays memory has become very cheaper for us. We don't much worry about the memory because it's very cheap, but time is very important for us, the fast execution speed. So day by day we need the process to be work very fast. I want the results to come very fast, right? So in our entire course, my primary focus for us when you are doing to do an analysis is the time complexity, right? So even though you have both time and space, but we give more concentration to time because space is very cheap. We are not bothered about the cheap algorithm. So this is what we say analyzing an algorithm. Next, what we are going to do, efficient algorithms. In our course, what we are going to study, so algorithms that make an efficient use of resources. Okay, when we say that algorithm is an efficient algorithm, based on these factors, right? So you are going to analyze based on time and space, and then you come to a conclusion, yes, this particular algorithm is a more efficient algorithm. That's what the first part or the first key in our title of our course, analysis. Next, we'll come to the design. Now, what do you mean by algorithmic design? Now, algorithmic design means method of designing efficient algorithm, because ultimately we need an efficient algorithm, right? So based on time and space. So now when you come up with an efficient algorithm, you have to design it. So in our course, we will be studying various designing techniques, right? So from module 2 onwards, now we have so many techniques we are going to study. Now each technique will be one unit. Okay, so we have different techniques, so different ways in which you are going to design. Right? You have one particular problem, you have got, let us say, 5 techniques are available. Now you have to select, okay, for this problem, which technique is good for me. So you select one technique for solving that particular problem. That's what we term it as analysis design. So you do an analysis of an algorithm based on time and space complexity. Then you try to design that based on various techniques which you are going to study in which you are going to study in this particular course. So this is what we try to understand. So the designing part, or what we can say, that analysis part. So let it be very clear that now we take an algorithm and we try to analyze that particular algorithm. So we have different designing techniques are available for us. Now we try to look into the various designing techniques. Now let us look into the what is the notation of an algorithm. So this is a very simple diagram now which you can see. So we have a problem. So to solve a problem, we are writing an algorithm, and this algorithm is sent to our computer, and we take the input, and the computer is going to process, and it just gives the output for us. So this is a very simple diagram which you all know how we are going to the notations of how we are going to solve the particular algorithm. Okay, so now we are going to come up with a very interesting we can say discussion, right? Okay, so now, so once we have understood clearly, the definition of an algorithm and what we are trying to understand in this particular course. So while designing an algorithm, we must look into the some of the important key factors which you are supposed to understand, right? So what are those key factors or important things we are supposed to remember in our mind? The first one is we cannot compromise non-ambiguity at any step. Right, we are not ready to compromise the ambiguity. So whatever the algorithms we are going to design, it should be very clear. The range of the input must be specified correctly. So this is also very important thing. The input range, that means one of the important characteristics of what we have already defined, is that how many inputs we should have in order to solve this particular problem. It should be very clearly defined. There should not be any confusion that, okay, how many inputs should be there, right? Similarly, we can represent same algorithm in different ways. So the same algorithm representation can be done in different ways, and different algorithm exist to solve the same problem. In order to solve a problem, so we need the different type of different methods are available for us, and so we say that different algorithm exists so in order to solve the same problem, but it depends upon the time. The speed of one algorithm may differ from the speed of another algorithm. So to illustrate this thing, now we'll try to take a simple example of finding the GCD of two numbers, right? So we are going to take a simple example of GCD, that is the greatest common factor or the greatest common divisor. So now let us see that in order to write an algorithm in order to solve this particular problem. So what is our problem? So finding the GCD of two numbers. So again, this slide is talking about the difference between algorithm and a program. I think it's very simple. It's I can just later in the transcript you can try to look what do you mean by the algorithm and what is the program what we are having. Okay, so anyhow, straight away we'll be going into the we'll take our first problem in order to understand. Okay, so as we are telling, we'll come to the first problem, that is finding the greatest common divisor of two numbers. Now let us see how we are going to define the problem. So the problem definition is also very important. Now what does the problem say? That we are supposed to find the greatest common divisor of two numbers. Now, as we told that in order to solve one problem, we have different methods are available for us. So let us see what are those methods. So in order to find the greatest common divisor, so you can see that you can call it as GCD of m comma n. So here we are going to discuss three important methods here. The first method, which we you might have learned in very school levels, and the second method slightly in secondary schools we have learned, and another very important method, that is when you are previous in undergraduates, when you have studied the C language or the data structures, there you might have written a program to find the GCD of two numbers, right? So now we will look into the first important method. So what is this particular method, which is called as? Okay, so now let us see the definitions. So what it says, let m and n be two non-negative integers. So we are taking two numbers here, m and n. Now such that at least one of them is non-zero. So we said while defining an algorithm, unambiguous instructions, right? So we clearly told that the instructions should be very clear. So now here also we are defining very clearly. So what we are saying, we take two numbers m and n, so non-negative integers, such that at least one of them is non-zero. So then we are going to come up with this first method to solve GCD, which is called as Euclid's algorithm. So this was again given by a famous mathematician, Euclid. So he gave this particular method. Now how does he define that? So Euclid's algorithm is defined in a recursive manner. So in recursive term it has been defined. So it has been defined like this. You can see here GCD of M comma N is equal to GCD of N comma M mod N. So we are going to give the problem statement. So GCD of M comma N is equal to GCD of N comma M mod N. Right? So let us take an example. So let us see how we are going to solve this particular problem. Okay. GCD of M comma N is equal to GCD of N comma M minus N. Okay. Let us I think slide is not moving properly. See here, this is how the let us see here. This is how the Euclid's algorithm is been defined or written. Okay, step one. So we know that we are given two numbers M and N. So you first we start with this checking the second number. If N is equal to 0, we return M. That means if the second number is 0, we directly return M and we stop our algorithm saying that the M itself is the GCD. Otherwise go to step 2. Now what does the step 2 says? That divide M by N. So divide M by N and assign the value of remainder to R. So you are going to divide M by N and get the remainder. As you already know that how to get the remainder. So in our C or in the programming language we use a modulus operator which gives us the remainder after dividing two numbers. We can use that mod operator and we try to get the remainder. And the third step says that assign the value of N to M and value of R to N. Right? We exchange N, we put N in M, and in the previous step whatever remainder we got we put that in N. So now M and N has been changed and we go back to step 1. So it is a recursive process. We keep on doing this until your second number becomes 0. Your second number becomes 0 so that you can return M. So now these step 1, step 2, step 3. So this is an algorithm. Okay. Now this is an algorithm wherein which we are writing it in a simple English language. So we are using the English sentences and we are going to write or represent an algorithm. Now in the down here you can see a little bit in a more stylish fashion, or you can say we have used some mnemonics. Okay, an algorithm can be represented also by using mnemonics wherein which you use some mathematical keys or keywords and symbols and try to reduce the English sentences. So here we can see that how we have written this algorithm. Now what we are saying, while N not equal to 0. So first you are going to check if N is not equal to 0, if second number is not equal to 0, we go inside the while loop and divide M by N. So M mod N, you can see here M mod N, you are going to divide M by N and whatever remainder you are going to get, because this modulus operator gives you the remainder. So this remainder is stored in R. So now once you have done this step, we are going to exchange N and R. So the whatever the value was there in the second number N, you put that in first number M, and the R remainder, what value you got in R, you put that in N. So now the both the number M and N has changed. Again you go to and check whether the N is 0 or not. If N is not 0, again keep on doing the while loop. So until you get the second number 0. So once your second number is 0, so that is what we are saying while N becomes 0. So in the step 1 we have said. So once when N becomes 0, so we are going to stop our algorithm. So we try to come out of our particular algorithm and we return M. So the M says that now you have stopped your particular program. So the M is nothing but the GCD of two numbers, right? So this is what the algorithm says. Now let us take a simple example and we'll try to see how we are going to solve by using. Yes. So this is an example. I think it will be very clear for us. So now GCD, what is the definition we are giving? GCD of m comma n is equal to GCD of n comma m mod n. So we want to find the greatest common divisor of 75 and 20, right? So what are the two numbers? The first number m is 75, the second number is 20 initially. So we take this definition and we write it. So GCD of 75 comma 20 is equal to GCD of n. Now you can see here we have got n. So GCD of 20 comma m mod n, that is 75 mod 20. Now we have to solve the RS, right hand side. Now if you look into your right hand side, here in the second argument we have got 75 mod 20. That means you are supposed to divide 75 by 20. Right? Now when you divide 75 by 20, so integer division, modulus operator means it does till integer division only you are going to stop. So when you divide 75 by 20, so till what you can divide? So you know that 20 3 times is 60. So now the remainder will be 15. So you get remainder as 15. So further you cannot continue your division process. You are going to stop it. So now your remainder becomes 15. So we write this as GCD of 20 comma 50. So now you are going to check this. Now is this second number equal to 0? No. Because the algorithm says that you repeat this until second number becomes 0. Now the second number is still not 0. It is 50. We do the same process. So now we will take in the second step GCD of 20 comma 50. Now the number has changed here actually. See, first it was 75, 20, m and n. So next what we have done is that n, that is the 20, we have put that in m. So n 20 goes into place of m value, and this remainder 15 goes in place of n value. That is what we have changed, the values of m and n. So now here GCD of 20 comma 50. So again we do the same process. So is equal to GCD of n, that is 15 comma m mod n, 20 mod 15. Again divide 20 by 15, integer division. So we know that 15 once is 15, remainder is 5. Okay, so now we got 15 and 5. So these are the two numbers, right? So again we check n value, which is 5, not equal to 0, do this process. So third time when you are doing, so it is GCD of 15 comma 5. Now this is GCD of 5 comma 15 mod 5. Now here when you divide 15 by 5, your remainder is 0. Now you can see that. So you got GCD of 5 comma 0. Now you check your second number n. So the second number n is equal to 0. Now since our second number n is equal to 0, we stop the particular process and we say that we got the GCD of 75 and 20. What is the GCD of 75 and 20? It is 5. This is how we do the Euclid's algorithm. This is how the Euclid's algorithm is been implemented. Okay, so till now we have seen the one method called as Euclid's algorithm. Now we will look into the another method, the second method to find the same problem, that is the GCD of two numbers. Now this method is called as consecutive integer checking algorithm. So this is another one particular method. Now what we do it in this particular method, you can see here step one. Now what we are doing in this particular method, step one says that assign the value of minimum of m comma n to t. So we take a variable t. Now given two numbers, m and n are the given two numbers. Now in that two numbers, whichever number is minimum, you take that number and put that number in t, right? So two numbers, whichever is minimum, you take that minimum number and assign it to a variable t. Second step, you divide m, you take the first number m, you divide it by t, and you check if the remainder is 0. Now you are going to divide m by the t. What is t? Minimum of the first given two numbers. So you divide m by t, and if the remainder is 0, you go to step 3. If your remainder is not 0, if you don't get a remainder is not 0, means you go to step 4. So in step 3 what you do, when you divide m by t and if your remainder is 0, you take second number. you are going to take the second number n and divide it by t. Again you check if remainder is 0. If the second number also, when you divide it by t, if your remainder is 0, then we stop our algorithm and we say that t itself is the GCD of two numbers. That is, you are going to return t. Right? Now, if your second number is not, after dividing it is not 0, that is remainder is not 0, we go to step 4. What we do in step 4 is, we decrement t by 1. We keep on decrementing t by 1 and go to step 2. Right? So, every time, so what you are going to do is, so you have given two numbers m and n. So, you take the minimum of these two numbers m, n and assign it to a variable t. So, once you have assigned that minimum of these two numbers into a variable t, second step, take the first number, keep on dividing it by t until you get the remainder 0. That means once you divide it by t, you should get remainder as 0. Right? So, once you get the remainder 0, you take the second number and keep on dividing it by that t until the second number also becomes 0. In any of the cases, when you divide and you are not going to get the second number as 0, so then what we try to do is we decrement t by 1. So we try to decrement t by 1 and again we try to follow the same steps. So now let us take an example and we'll try to see it. Yes. Now this is let us take a simple example. Okay, we have to find GCD of 9, 6. So what is the first given two numbers? M is equal to 9, n is equal to 6. So we are using the second method, that is consecutive integer checking. So first step, what we do, we find the minimum of these two numbers. What are the two numbers given? 9 and 6. In these two, which is minimum? 6 is the minimum. So we put that 6 in t. So we are going to store that 6 in t. Second step, now what we do, we take the first number m, which is 9, and divide it by t. So 9 mod 6, and we check the remainder. So when you do 9 mod 6, remainder is 3. And you see that remainder not equal to 0. So since the remainder is not equal to 0, we go to step 4, and what we do in step 4, we decrement t by 1. Right? So what we do, since remainder is not equal to 0, you decrement t by 1. So what was t here? T was 6, you decrement it by 1, so t becomes 5. T becomes 5 here. Now do the same step. You take the first number 9, divide it by 5, now t is 5, and check the remainder. So 9 mod 5, remainder is 4, it is not 0, decrement this t 4 by 1, right? So it becomes 9 mod 4. So again 9 mod 4, what is the remainder? You get 1. Again this remainder is not equal to 0, so decrement this t value 4 by 1, it becomes 3. Now 9 mod 3, when you divide 9 by 3, the remainder is 0, right? So now you got the 0. When you started dividing the first number 9, now you got 0. Once you get 0, that is the remainder is 0, we go to step 3. Now what this step 3 says, you take the second number. Now we have to do the same process what you have done here with your second number 6. So what is your t value now? T is 3 now, right? Now you take the second number 6, you divide it by 3 and check what is the remainder. So 6 mod 3, remainder is 0. So now remainder becomes 0. So now here also remainder is 0. Once remainder is 0, we stop and we return t. So what is t value? T is 3. So GCD of 6, GCD of 9, 6 is the 3, right? So this is the second method of to find the GCD of two numbers. And we have the third method to find the GCD of two numbers. Now what is this? So elementary school method. So we can find the GCD of two numbers using the old or very method of finding the prime factors. Now what does this say is that find the prime factor of both the numbers. So you have to find GCD of m and n. So what we do, first step, find all the prime factors of m. Second step, find all the prime factors of n. And third step, what we do, we identify all common prime factors. So which are the common prime factors of m and prime factors of n, you try to identify it and find the product of that. So that will give you the GCD of two numbers. Let us go back to that previous problem, that is GCD of 75, 20. So first step, find the prime factors of 75. So when you find the prime factors of 75, it is 3 × 5 × 5, right? Similarly, write down the prime factors of 20, which is 2 × 2 × 5, right? So now in these two prime factors, you identify which is the common. Now you can see here 5 is common in both, that is the as the prime factor. So we can declare, or we can declare our result, which says that GCD of two numbers are 5, right? So this is another important method which we have seen in order to find the GCD of two numbers. So till now, so let's stop this particular class here. Till now, what all in an outline, so what we have studied is an algorithm. Try to understand the definition of the important characteristics of an algorithm, and what are the ways in which, or what do you mean by the actual title of our course, analysis. What is an analysis of an algorithm, designing of an algorithm, and we have seen taken a simple example, and we have seen that how we can use different methods in order to solve a particular problem, how we can have different algorithm for same one particular problem. So in the next class, we will be looking into the fundamentals of algorithm problem solving. That means in order to solve a problem, we should have certain steps. What are those steps? We'll try to look into our next class. So if you have got any doubt, so you can feel free, you can text it in WhatsApp, or you can in the classroom, you can try to give whatever the feedback, or if you are not able to understand, we will discuss that in the tomorrow's session. Thank you. Have a nice day.